The assassination of President John Kennedy on November 22, 1963, remains one of the most compelling murder mysteries of the century. The man officially held accountable was, of course, Lee Harvey Oswald. It seemed that throughout his 24-year life, Lee Harvey Oswald desperately wanted to be somebody important, to change the world somehow, to teach it a lesson. On November 22, 1963, the world did change, and Oswald was at the center of it all.
Coming in. We now switch you directly to Parkland Hospital.
It's official. As of just a few moments ago, the President of the United States is dead.
Just 45 minutes after the assassination of President John F. Kennedy, a Dallas police officer who was on the lookout for the killer was himself shot and killed. Arrested for that murder just moments later, a 24-year-old ex-Marine, Lee Harvey Oswald. The cops who arrested Oswald brought him downtown to the police station, which was mobbed by reporters desperate for information on the death of the president.
Has the gentleman been identified?
Yes, sir, he's been identified for killing the officer.
Right. Has any identification been attempted for the killing of the president?
Not yet.
Not yet.
But it quickly became apparent that the thin, brown-haired Oswald matched an eyewitness description of a man who had fled a building overlooking Dealey Plaza shortly after the fatal shots were fired.
I work in that building.
Were you in the building at the time?
Naturally, if I work in that building, yes, sir.
Back up, man.
Did you shoot the president?
No, they're taking me in because of the fact that I live in the Soviet Union. I'm just a patsy.
Lee Harvey Oswald was born in New Orleans on October 18, 1939, just 2 months after his father, an insurance salesman, had died of a heart attack. Lee's mother, Marguerite, quickly discovered that caring for her three boys, John from her first marriage, Robert Jr., and the newborn Lee, was more than she could handle.
She was constantly complaining about not having enough money, not enough food in the house, not of this. We were a burden. It was obvious we were a burden. And we felt, this is why she was always shipping us off to someplace, you know. And we understood it. She was having a hard time, but, you know, we wanted to be there. We wanted to be a family type thing. It was natural, but it wasn't to be.
In 1942, the three-year-old Lee and his brothers were placed in an orphanage where they lived with 100 other children. Lee slept in a bed next to Robert, who made sure that no one picked on his baby brother. A year later, Lee's mother met an electrical engineer named Edwin Ekdahl. They took the boys out of the orphanage, married, and moved into a large house in Dallas. Lee got along with his new stepfather, who took him on business trips and bought him toys. And for the first time, Lee had someone who put a measure of stability into his life. But the stability was fleeting. Lee's mother and stepfather argued frequently and separated numerous times. In 1948, after 3 years of marriage, they divorced.
Things just started going downhill again, type thing, from the economical standpoint. We ended up in a small house in Benbrook, Texas. And that's where Lee started the first grade.
Most of the kids in our neighborhood were into football, being 10 years old. So we were into football and baseball and sneaking off, hoping we didn't get caught. Lee was not excluded by the kids in the neighborhood, but he didn't really offer to participate too much.
With the family's arrival in Benbrook, Texas, the young Lee Harvey had already moved 8 times in 6 years. He was constantly adjusting to new surroundings, new faces.
He changed schools so frequently that even if he had had the nature, which he really didn't, to form friends and to settle into somebody close, he never had that opportunity.
It certainly did not help matters that his mother was overbearing to an extreme, controllingly and smothering him.
They slept in the same bed till Lee was about 11 years old. He's a lonely boy, extraordinarily lonely, read all the time. And she filled his ego with the idea that he was extraordinarily important. She was impressed with everything he did. She was the kind of mother who, if he opened his mouth and said something, she'd say, "You're so brilliant. You're wonderful. You're going to be something extraordinary." On the other hand, she was very tough to deal with, so by the time he grew up, he really half-hated her.
And I think it just had a devastating effect on Lee. His exposure, and without exception, she had to be the most significant person in his life. He couldn't get away from her fast enough.
Lee rebelled by being demanding, aggressive, hard to control, at times violent. In 1952, when Lee was 12, he and his mother journeyed north to New York City, where Lee's half-brother John was now stationed in the Coast Guard.
They're just there, quote, for a short visit, but it becomes a longer stay, okay? And there's friction between John and mother, John's wife and Lee, okay? They have a big argument about something, about Lee was threatening her with a knife and everything. So John says, okay, that does it, you gotta go.
So mother and child moved away from the family to a one-room basement apartment in the Bronx. In school, the other kids teased Lee because of his shabby clothes and his southern accent. So Lee stopped going to school.
He was missing like 4 out of 5 days out of the week. And it went over to about 100 and some odd days of the school term that he had missed.
He played hooky so frequently that for 3 weeks in 1953, he was placed in a home for juvenile delinquents and required to undergo psychiatric evaluation. Counselors found the 14-year-old Lee to be withdrawn and emotionally disturbed.
He had no friends. He spent most of his time by himself. He told me, I remember his saying to me, that there was kind of a veil between him and other people, and he liked it like that. He didn't want anybody to pull aside the veil.
Lee's sense of isolation only intensified as he grew older, aggravated by his mother's obsession with his sexuality. She gave him no privacy and made Lee feel insecure about his body by voicing her concern that Lee had some kind of sexual problem, even though doctors saw no evidence of one.
She said, well, had they looked down there? And I said, you know, I assumed so. I don't know. There was nothing that they found that was, at all remarkable. She also told me she used to bathe all her kids herself until they were about 10 or 11, and then they got too big down there for her to look at.
To get away from his mother, Lee wandered the streets of New York, memorizing the subway system and visiting the Bronx Zoo, a young boy all alone in the big city, susceptible to whatever influences came along, including political ones.
Young Lee Harvey Oswald, with no association and nothing to latch onto in life, gets a pamphlet one day from a woman on a street corner in New York, and it turns out to be about the Rosenberg case, people charged for selling state secrets on the atomic bomb to the Soviet Union. And suddenly he reads it, and he latches onto something in this sort of life that's looking for a purpose and aim, and it happens to be a political philosophy, and it's communism.
He read the Communist Manifesto when he was about 15, and already I think there's this style implicit in him that he was going to find a separate solution for everything in his life.
His mother's solution to his truancy problems was to pick up and move back to New Orleans, and soon after to Fort Worth, Texas. Despite his communist leanings, Lee decided he wanted to follow in the footsteps of his older brother Robert and enlist in the Marines.
He admired somebody, and that was Robert Oswald. He looked up to his brother, and his brother had escaped the oppression of that household by going to the Marine Corps, and that was Lee's ticket to freedom.
In October 1956, when he turned 17, Lee Harvey Oswald signed up immediately. It was the opportunity he had longed for, a chance to escape from his mother and his first step toward finding that separate solution for his life. A quest that would eventually lead Oswald to a place few Americans ventured during the height of the Cold War, the Soviet Union. In the fall of 1956, Lee Harvey Oswald was so eager to escape from his oppressive mother and start life on his own that he rushed off to Marine boot camp just 1 week after his 17th birthday. At the recruit depot in San Diego, Oswald shared a Quonset hut with Michael Toby, but made no effort to be friendly.
Living that close together for 3 months, you got to know a little story about everybody, except him. I mean, he was just there. He didn't get in trouble. He wasn't outstanding. He didn't necessarily have a pack of guys that he was friendly with. He didn't sit around and shoot the breeze with us.
After qualifying on the firing range as a sharpshooter and training in aircraft surveillance and radar, Oswald shipped out to the Atsugi Air Base outside Tokyo. He quickly managed to alienate his superiors by trying to prove at every turn that he was smarter and better informed than they were about public affairs.
He started asking them foreign policy questions, like, what do you think of Mossadegh in Afghanistan, or wherever Mossadegh was, and they wouldn't know what he was talking about. And then he turned to his commanding officer afterward and say, why is it that they're officers and I'm not, and I know more about foreign policy than they do? And of course his commanding officer would say to him in effect, well, man, what we're doing here is radar, and foreign policy doesn't enter it over here. We're just working these radar machines.
Quickly, this career that he hopes will take off doesn't take off at all. As a matter of fact, he's court-martialed once for shooting himself with a pistol that he's not supposed to have. Another time, he attacks a senior officer and gets into a fight.
In June 1958, Lee was sentenced to 28 days in military prison. It made him bitter.
He hated the brig. He hated the Marine Corps. He felt they'd oppressed him, that they denied him, that they didn't appreciate him. The key thing was that they didn't have an understanding of how brilliant he was.
Disgusted with the Marines, but still searching for some way to distinguish himself, Lee turned once again to communism. His interest in the Soviet Union intensified. He began to study Russian. Fellow Marines called him Oswaldskovich.
He had Russian records. He would play chess with people and ask for the red pieces or checkers. He would answer ya if you asked him a question about something. And people viewed him not as a security threat, not as somebody who was a Russian spy, but just sort of as a quirky person who was to be avoided. He was almost a joke at this point.
By 1959, Oswald was such a failure as a Marine that he was reduced to janitorial work. He began maneuvering to get out of the service. Lee's mother, back in Texas, anxious to get him home, came up with a flimsy excuse.
Mother had an accident at the place that she was working and applied to get him out on early discharge on the premise that he would come home and help her support herself. And that procedure went through, so consequently he was discharged in early September of 59.
But life with his domineering mother was not what Lee had in mind. Just 2 days after arriving in Fort Worth, he headed off for New Orleans, then purchased a one-way boat ticket for passage to Europe. Lee wrote his mother a quick goodbye letter telling her he did not expect her to understand his plans.
Mother has a letter from him saying that, you know, he's going to go to Russia.
Lee arrived in Helsinki in October 1959 and applied for a visa from the Soviet consulate, saying he was a student traveler. He did not mention that he'd been a Marine. Within 2 days, he was granted permission to take a 6-day trip to the Soviet Union. The 19-year-old Lee had been developing a secret plan. He would show up as a tourist and then defect.
Oswald went over to Russia with the idea that they'd be enormously excited by his arrival. He may have known that no Marine had ever defected before. He thought he would be an international figure, and that the Russians would take him most seriously, use him for propaganda, and he would become a large figure in Russian life.
Once in Moscow, Lee and his Russian guide went on a sightseeing tour. Later that day, he told the guide he wanted to apply for Soviet citizenship. But the Soviet authorities showed no special interest, since Oswald was not a high-level defector who could reveal American secrets.
When I talked to Yuri Nosenko, who was the Russian intelligence officer who handled Oswald's file, he said directly, no, I'll tell you what we were interested in. Did he know military intelligence? If he had been a Marine guard at the U.S. Embassy, then our antennas would have gone up. We would have been very interested because he could get information for us. But what did he have to offer? Not everybody who came across the transom had intelligence value.
Oswald spent his 20th birthday, October 18th, 1959, visiting Lenin's tomb and waiting for a final word from the Soviet government. In typical bureaucratic fashion, the authorities stalled.
The idea that anything could happen quickly was alien to the very process of Soviet life. So when this fellow came over, the first attitude was, He must be a spy. Then the KGB began to say, but he is so unlikely. He doesn't fit the pattern. And then they thought, well, maybe the CIA is doing something new. Maybe they're sending over an oddball to see how we react.
Finally, the Soviets made a decision. On October 21st, the day before Lee's visa was to expire, Soviet officials informed Oswald that his request for citizenship had been denied. He would have to leave Moscow within 2 hours. In a diary, Lee wrote, "My fondest dreams are shattered." Back in his hotel room, Lee took a knife and slit his left wrist. His tour guide discovered him there, unconscious, and rushed him to the hospital where he was stabilized. The following week, Lee was released and placed in a hotel while the Soviets decided what to do next. But Lee, determined to stay in Russia, had his own plan. On October 31st, he showed up at the U.S. Embassy.
He told me, in effect, that he came there to give up his American citizenship. And, will I please get on with it quickly, that he didn't want any lectures from me, and he didn't want to enter into any discussions with me. He said to me, "I intend to make available to the Soviet authorities everything I've learned about the Marine Corps and as a radar operator."
But diplomat Richard Snyder told Oswald the embassy was now closed for the day, and he would have to come back. Lee stormed out, proud that he had shown great bravery in standing up to American officials. Now the Russians were even more confused about how to handle this odd American.
They have two choices, the Russians. Do we put him on a plane and force him back to the United States, or do we let him stay here and don't give him citizenship? And they opt for the second. Let him stay here. We'll move him out to a provincial capital, 450 miles from Moscow. Move him out to Minsk.
A city where it would be easier for the KGB to keep a close eye on Oswald. The Soviets arranged a job for him as a metal worker in a radio and television factory, something Lee knew nothing about, but he accepted his fate.
He ended up in a very fancy apartment building with a very small apartment. He was making as much money as the head of the factory. There he was. He was living. He was an American. He was a bit of a movie star to the local Minsk people, the only American they'd ever seen. The girls would all pass him in the radio shop and say, "Hello, Alec." They called him Alec. "Hello, Alec. How are you?" Hoping that he'd take a rise.
For the first few months, Lee flourished in his new role. He loved the attention. For the first time in his life, he made many friends, went to parties, to the movies, and joined a hunting club. In his diary, he wrote, "I am living big and am very satisfied."
He writes a letter saying he's going to sever all connections with all members of the family. He's going to live in Russia for the rest of his life. You know, he wants nothing to do with the United States. It's quite disheartening.
Soon, Lee started to date, including one beautiful 19-year-old named Marina Persikova.
Marina was a very attractive girl, marvelous blue eyes. She was interested in Lee because an American was a catch. On the other hand, she was only half taken with him. She mentioned that she really didn't like his smell, that he had an odd odor, wasn't disagreeable exactly, just an odd odor, and it was always with him.
But, like Lee, Marina was searching for a way out of her own difficult childhood. Lee, the rare foreigner with his own apartment, seemed to offer just that. After only 2 months of dating, they married in April 1961.
The KGB recorded a great many of their dialogues. The fights they had were absolutely absurd but classic, you know, on the order of, "What do you mean I did not wash the floor? I've washed that floor 21 times. You've only washed it once, and you come in here and your shoes are dirty. You track up the floor." So it's a comedy because what you've got is people saying strong, strong things to one another, and all recorded by the KGB, listening in, saying, "Is this a spy? Is this not a spy? What is her role? What's her relation?" So taking it very seriously. On the other hand, they're two young people just having these dumb fights.
Marina gave birth to a daughter, June Lee Oswald, in February 1962. But by now, Lee was realizing that life in the supposed communist paradise was boring and endlessly bureaucratic. He had lost his enthusiasm for patriotic duties such as picking potatoes at the state collective farm. Unbeknownst to Marina, he was already making plans to return to the United States. Oswald began writing to the U.S. Embassy in Moscow.
He wanted his passport back and made some motions, you know, of contrition, said, "I've learned a hard lesson the hard way," was the major part of it, but things weren't what he had expected.
Approval to return to the U.S. involved mountains of Soviet and American paperwork. It took almost a year before Lee and Marina and their newborn daughter were given permission to leave in June 1962. The egotistical Lee had assured Marina that his arrival would be widely covered by the press. After all, he could tell Americans what life was really like in Russia. But when they got to New York, not a single reporter was waiting to hear Lee's words of wisdom.
From there, they fly to Dallas Love Field, at which time we meet the plane, my wife and I. He says, "What, no reporters?" I said, "No, I managed to keep it quiet." And he did seem a little bit disappointed on that aspect of it.
Lee Harvey Oswald's uneventful return to the United States was another bitter reminder of his failure to prove his importance. He was frustrated, and his behavior began to grow increasingly violent, so much so that he would soon find a new outlet for his anger, assassination. Lee Harvey Oswald arrived in Texas in the summer of 1962 with a tarnished military record, no high school degree, and no job. The FBI was keeping a close eye on him, and Oswald knew it. After all, he had denounced the U.S. and lived in Russia at a time of great tension between the superpowers. Lee's wife, Marina, who spoke no English, found that Lee, a celebrity in Minsk, was a nobody in America, and she let him know it.
He would say to her in Russian, you know, it comes out literally, "you and your long tongue," dlinny yazyk, but it was, he meant her sharp tongue. He just meant that she just goaded him beyond bearing with the things that she said to him. So she made fun of him and ridiculed him, and sometimes he couldn't stand it.
In the presence of relatives, Lee and Marina seemed like a happy couple. Just 5 months after Lee's return, they attended an Oswald family reunion in Dallas.
November 22nd, 1962 was Thanksgiving Day. We all were together for the first time. The years seemed to just melt away as type thing as everybody gets caught up. Everybody's having a good time.
But in private, Lee and Marina were miserable. He had begun to beat her. Their marriage was crumbling. One fight turned so violent, it drove them even further apart.
She was lying on the bed, and he almost choked her to death. Luckily, the baby cried, and Lee jumped up and went to attend to the baby. Then Marina went and stood on the toilet seat and tried to hang herself.
And he finds her, sees her doing it, says, "You fool," pulls it down, and beats her again. And that's how the Oswalds' relationship develops in 62.
Life quieted down somewhat in late 62 when Lee found a job he liked, developing photographs for a graphic arts company. But his job performance quickly deteriorated, and co-workers complained about his inconsiderate and aggressive behavior.
He was a sloppy worker, he was a casual worker, he was a goofy worker. He'd do odd things. He'd pass his foreman and take out and go, pow!
Frustrated with his career and marriage, and annoyed that the FBI was still keeping tabs on him, Oswald turned his energy back to radical politics. He wrote letters to fringe left-wing organizations, including one called the Fair Play for Cuba Committee. Disappointed with what he saw as the corruption of both the Soviet Union and the United States, Lee then made a decisive leap from political activist to political assassin.
Oswald has decided on a new course of action. He's been through the theory. He's been through the philosophizing. He's been to the Soviet Union. It doesn't work. By early 1963, Lee Harvey Oswald has committed himself to political assassination to change the system.
He spent $20 on two mail-order weapons, a pistol and a rifle with a four-power scope. Lee picked a convenient target right in Dallas, a retired general named Edwin Walker.
Walker is really an up-and-coming right-wing politician, former Army general. He's run for the governor's position in Texas. John Bircher, very strong right of center.
The night of April 10th, 1963, after having been fired from his job, Lee took action.
Walker is in his study doing his taxes. Oswald, about 65 feet away near a fence, sets up, aims with his four-power scope in the Mannlicher Carcano, takes one shot at Walker's head.
And he rushed home that night, breathless. Turned on the radio, waited to hear news whether Walker had been killed. And when the hours passed and the news came over the radio that someone had shot at General Walker, Lee said to Marina, "Oh, I just barely missed him. If he hadn't moved his head at the last minute, I would have killed him."
The bullet had nicked the wooden sash on a window and missed Walker's head by a fraction of an inch. After weeks of planning, Lee had failed once again. Afraid the police might find him, he decided to skip town. A new friend of Marina's, named Ruth Payne, unaware of Lee's assassination attempt, offered to help the struggling couple.
He had apparently lost his job and was planning to go to New Orleans. So I suggested that Marina might stay with me while he was looking for work.
Marina took Ruth up on her offer and moved into her house. In May, Lee headed for New Orleans, where 2 weeks later he got a job at a coffee company. Marina joined him there. Soon after, Lee started his very own chapter of the Fair Play for Cuba Committee.
To me, it's another indication of he's wanting attention. He wants to draw attention to himself. For what purpose? I don't know. It's different, though. Everybody down there is against Cuba, I guess. You know, but he wants fair play for Cuba. It's American and Russian. You know, what side you on? Hey, what side gets attention?
Lee made thousands of leaflets for his pro-Cuba group and in the sweltering summer heat handed them out to passers-by. So odd a sight, it caught the eye of the local media.
I was instructed by my TV station to find out if he was going to hand out leaflets again. We might be interested in filming him doing that. So he set up the next leafleting, which was Friday, August 16th, at the Trademark down on Camp Street.
In your work with the Fair Play for Cuba Committee, what are you advocating?
We advocate restoration of diplomatic, trade, and tourist relations with Cuba.
Things were picking up for Lee. In addition to the TV appearance, he was invited to appear on a radio debate show to discuss his radical views.
He was the kind of person who could hold his own despite a tremendous array of facts and antagonism and hostility against him, because that's exactly what happened when he went on radio with us.
How many people do you have on your committee here in New Orleans?
I cannot reveal that as secretary of the Fair Play for Cuba Committee.
I believe it was mentioned that you at one time asked to renounce your American citizenship and become a citizen of the Soviet Union. Is that correct?
Well, I don't think that has a particular import to this discussion.
But Lee's moment in the spotlight was just a passing media curiosity, and Marina could tell it did not satisfy his desperate longing for attention.
He sits on the porch of their house on Magazine Street in the sweltering heat of New Orleans with his gun, and he would do dry runs with the bolt action. And she would hear him inside the house, just the clicking of the bolt, time after time after time, operating the bolt as he sat there.
In the summer of 1963, he broke down in the kitchen in New Orleans, just sobbing and sobbing, and told her he just didn't know what to do with himself. He didn't know what to do with his life.
Marina was now 8 months pregnant with their second child and unable to afford a visit to the doctor. She returned to her friend Ruth Payne's house in Dallas, leaving Lee alone in New Orleans, where his depression deepened further.
So he has a debate, you know, he's making progress, he's getting some attention, he's getting some exposure. Maybe something good's going to come out of it in his mind, but it doesn't. It just kind of goes downhill. So he leaves and goes to Mexico. Maybe he needs to go to Cuba. Maybe he can go back to Russia from Cuba.
In a replay of his earlier attempt to defect to the Soviet Union, Oswald boarded a bus for Mexico City, where he made one last desperate effort to gain attention through nonviolent means. He showed up at the Cuban consulate and demanded a visa.
And guess what? He's rejected again for another time in his life. They say, no way. Get out of here. We're not going to give you an immediate visa. Apply like everyone else. And Oswald is devastated. He goes to the Soviet consulate. He decides the Soviets will help him.
The Soviet consulate also rejected Oswald's plea for a visa. He took the long bus ride back to Dallas, so shocked by his accumulated failures that even his estranged wife, Marina, felt pity for him.
Lee returned from Mexico City and then called Marina, but he didn't tell her much about what happened. He came back quite a changed person, very subdued. He'd suffered a setback, and she did not rub his nose in that. She understood that there'd been a failure there.
From his days in elementary school, through military service and life in the Soviet Union, Lee had been unable to prove his importance. Now, back in Dallas, unemployed and separated from his wife and child, he would try once more to make something of himself. This time, he'd succeed. was a depressed and angry Lee Harvey Oswald who returned from Mexico City to Dallas in October 1963, just 2 weeks before the birth of his second daughter, Rachel. Nonetheless, Lee was determined to finally prove to himself and his estranged wife that he was someone important. He took a room at a boarding house, visiting his family at Ruth Payne's only on weekends, and once again began to look for a job.
He was worried, you know, about getting a job. And of course she was worried. And one time we were over next door at a neighbor's having some coffee in the morning and talking, and mentioned that he was looking for work. There were two other women there besides ourselves, and one of them said, well, my brother works at the school book depository in Dallas, and I understand they're looking for people, or they might be still hiring.
Lee took the tip. He was hired as a clerk to fill book orders. The would-be assassin, who just 7 months earlier had tried to kill General Edwin Walker, now learned that a far more prominent target, President John F. Kennedy, would be visiting Dallas on November 22nd. The motorcade route, which would take the president right under the windows of the book depository, was published in the local newspapers.
And suddenly this newspaper is challenging him by saying, you have an opportunity to make it Kennedy. It is hard to overstate the impact that that would have had on Oswald. To read that he had a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to put a cog into the machinery of government that would never come his way again.
Thursday, November 21st. After work, instead of returning to the boarding house, as he usually did, Lee went to see Marina at Ruth Payne's house. After dinner, Lee spent some time alone in the garage.
I noticed that the light was on, so I assumed that he had been out there and just forgot to turn the light off. Of course, what I didn't know was that there had been a gun in the garage.
During the course of the night, he couldn't sleep. He was restless. Marina remembers it was about 5 o'clock until he finally fell asleep. At one point, she rested her leg against his, and he pushed it away with such a ferocity that she thought, my God, he's in a mean mood tonight.
And early in the morning, she found him by the bed, standing there, and he said, don't get up, Mama. I've left some money on the bureau. Buy some shoes for Junie. And Marina went back to sleep.
When she got up, Marina discovered that Lee had left $170 on the dresser, nearly their entire life savings. And next to the money, Lee had left his wedding ring. That morning, November 22nd, as President Kennedy was making a speech in nearby Fort Worth, Oswald got a ride to work from one of Ruth Payne's neighbors. Lee was carrying a package wrapped in brown paper. He told the neighbor it was curtain rods. Oswald reported to work as usual.
At a few minutes to 12, with a group of workers on the sixth floor, repairing the floor, they all leave to go to lunch. Oswald stays behind. One of them goes back up a couple of minutes later. It's now about noon. And he sees Lee Harvey Oswald all alone on the sixth floor of the Texas School Book Depository at a few minutes after 12.
We heard a shot. And I was standing in an opening in the center of Dealey Plaza, and I said, somebody's shooting firecrackers, you know. But the next shot got my attention. No, no, that's a gun. And then the third shot that I heard, his head exploded. And I see all this matter coming out of his head.
You know, just an orange halo around his head. It was very frightening. You began to get the feeling that people were in terror.
Everybody fell to the ground.
Eyewitnesses said they had seen a gunman in the sixth floor window of the book depository. As police began searching the building, Oswald fled.
Oswald walks out the front of the building, grabs a bus. The bus is stuck in traffic, and for the first time in his life, the great penny pincher takes a taxi cab, which shows some ability of flight.
President Kennedy was rushed to Parkland Hospital.
We ran into trauma room one, and there was the president on a gurney, with Mrs. Kennedy standing at the foot of the gurney.
Within 10 minutes, it was determined that he was not salvageable. And during that time, we had an opportunity to look at the head wound and see the massive injury that he had sustained.
By now, Dallas police were conducting an all-point search for the gunman based on an eyewitness description of a young man fleeing the book depository. At 1:15 p.m., Officer J.D. Tippett saw a man who matched the description. Tippett slowly pulled his patrol car to the side of the road and stepped out. In front of a dozen witnesses, Lee took out his pistol and shot Tippit 5 times, killing him. Lee ran down the street, but he was spotted as he ducked into a movie theater. Dallas police officers found him inside. As Lee grabbed for his pistol, the policeman wrestled him to the ground and arrested him.
November 22nd, 1963. I'm at lunch with a group of businessmen. As we're leaving a restaurant, the waitress basically says, "Have y'all heard that there's been a shooting in Dallas and the president has been shot?" Listen to the radio. I hear the name Lee Harvey Oswald.
My thought was, it's Friday, he'll probably be out for the weekend. He'll tell us about it.
Instead, that evening, 6 Dallas police officers arrived at Ruth's door.
And one asked whether Lee had had a gun, and I said no, which was wrong, and then translated to Marina, who said yes he did, and showed in the garage where this blanket roll was, and the officer picked up the roll in such a way that it folded over his arm, and it was clear that it was empty. There was nothing stiff or metal inside it, and that was when I felt like, oh, it really could have been him.
It soon became known that Lee Harvey Oswald had been in the book depository when the president was shot, and that he matched an eyewitness description of the suspected assassin. Lee was finally getting the attention he had longed for. The Dallas police station was already filled with reporters trying to get information on the assassination of President Kennedy when the 24-year-old Lee Harvey Oswald was brought in and charged with killing Officer J.D. Tippit. He was also the prime suspect in the murder of the president. He had the attention of the whole world.
I'd like some legal representation. These police officers have not allowed me to have any. I don't know what this is all about.
Kill the president?
No, sir, I didn't. People keep asking me that.
Sir?
You shoot the president?
I work in that building.
Were you in the building at the time?
Naturally, if I work in that building, yes, sir.
Back up, man!
Did you shoot the president?
No, they're taking me in because of the fact that I live in the Soviet Union. I'm just a patsy.
Late that night, Dallas police let Oswald speak to the press.
Did you kill the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet. The first thing I heard about it was when the newspaper reporters in the hall asked me that question.
The following day, Saturday, Lee's older brother Robert was allowed to speak with him. Lee, who was now charged with killing President Kennedy, seemed more concerned with getting new shoes for his daughter than with the accusations against him.
And I said, "Hey, brother, don't worry about that. I'll take care of that, okay? No problem." Finally, wanted to get down to the crux of the matter and said, "Lee, what Sammy has going on?" And he said, "Well, I don't know." And I said, "Wait a minute. They have your rifle and they have your pistol. They've got you charged with the killing of the president and a police officer. And you don't know what's going on." "No, I don't believe all that so-called evidence." And I was looking for some sign of something, emotion or fear or anything, you know. And there was nothing there. And he became aware of it. He says, "Brother, you won't find anything there." And I said, "You know, you're right."
Dallas police were having their own troubles interrogating Oswald because the police station was so mobbed with reporters from around the world.
It was not conducive to good interrogation, and that was one of the reasons that the decision was made to move him to the county jail, because we could eliminate all of that.
But now, someone was stalking Oswald, a petty mobster and nightclub owner named Jack Ruby, a man who made it his business to be friendly to cops so he had easy access to the police station. Ruby is seen here posing as a reporter at Lee's news conference, a man who would walk onto the stage of history for a split second, but whose real motives would never be known. Sunday morning, November 24th, with Americans glued to their TV sets watching the president's funeral, Dallas police have made a last-minute change in plans. Jack Ruby hears about it.
He turned on his car radio to see whether Oswald had been moved during the night, as he was supposed to be, and learned that because the Dallas police were accommodating the press, the transfer had taken place not in the middle of the night, but in the morning.
He strolls over to the police station, goes down the ramp, and lo and behold, there is Oswald right in front of him.
The TV networks were now covering Oswald's transfer live.
God gave him Oswald. He takes out his pistol, he shoots
him. I saw Ruby coming, which I did. I saw him as he stepped out. I didn't have time to do much. I tried to pull him behind me. He went down almost immediately. He groaned and went down.
One of the agents walked over to me in the parking lot and said, Robert, Lee's been shot. We understand it's not serious, but he's been shot.
Lee Harvey Oswald was rushed to the same hospital where President Kennedy had died 2 days earlier.
There was a lot of anxiety at that point. We were just winding down from the assassination a little bit, and then here it was starting all over again.
I'm sitting with a Secret Service agent, and phone rings in that office. He picks it up, and whomever is talking to him, he says, would you please repeat that? And he repeats it, and he hangs up the phone, and he turns to me. He says, Robert, he says, I'm sorry, but he's expired. Yeah, I just another thing that weekend, pretty hard to talk about.
The Oswald family, still in shock from both the assassination and Lee's murder, had trouble finding a priest, a funeral home, and a cemetery that would agree to bury the most hated man in America.
Finally, they had one individual that was acceptable and agreeable. We go to the cemetery. They've already taken the coffin from the little chapel that we were going to have the services at, and the reporters have carried it down to the gravesite. I mean, I blew my cool in that chapel. I beat my fist on the wall.
In the years since the assassination, Americans have longed for an explanation they could live with, some convenient conspiracy.
I think the greatest kickoff for the conspiracy is Ruby's murder of Oswald. If you ask people to believe that life can be chaotic and that your whole life and the history of this country can change because one sociopath armed with what was a $12 rifle can take shots and change the course of history, that's hard enough for people to accept. But now you're asking them to believe that two people, both out of sync in their lives, crossed paths that weekend in Dallas.
Let's recognize that the assassination of Kennedy sits like an incubus upon us. How much did the CIA have to do with it? How much did the FBI have to do with it? How much did the mafia have to do with it? The paranoia in this country has been enormous since that assassination. It just was as if they took a huge blanket and put it all over everything. And the ripples of that the dust that flew out from that huge blanket coming down over everything, created an air of dust in American perception that became radioactive dust. Everybody saw plots everywhere.
But in the end, the only real plot may have been the one festering inside Lee Harvey Oswald, and ironically fueled by the government agents who Lee knew had been keeping an eye on him since his return from Russia.
He was affected to a great degree by the way he was observed. That intensified his sense of ego, his sense that he was an extraordinary man. Oswald felt that the CIA and the FBI were after him and observing him. That absolutely intensified his monomania about being extraordinary.
That one moment where he pulled the trigger said to every kid that had ever pushed him around, said to every Marine that called him Mrs. Oswald and shoved him in the showers, said to the Russians who told him to get lost, to the Cubans who said he was no good, to the people in New Orleans who shoved him aside, hey, guess what? You're wrong. I am better than you. I am clever, and I do stand out.
You cannot get away from the facts, and it is his rifle, his pistol. He had the general opportunity, even if no one saw him actually do it. The time period is there. You have the eyewitnesses involved with the shooting of police officer Tippit. You cannot explain one without the other. There's been those who have tried, you know, the spin masters or whatever, but it's all there. I say it's concrete. It was the act of one man only, okay? Lee acted alone. And the only conspiracy involved was the one that he created himself.
More than 30 years after the Kennedy assassination, conspiracy theories surrounding the murder persist. We may never conclusively know whether Lee Harvey Oswald murdered President Kennedy, but his name will forever be linked with that assassination. So he got the fame he sought.